Hey guys, welcome or welcome back to my channel. This is Sandra and I make videos all about cybersecurity, having a career in technology, and work vlogs. So if you're new to my channel, just a little bit of background. I am currently working as a security analyst and I'm also part of a rotation program and I graduate from it in June of this year. So I will be officially starting my permanent role after that. And I just wanted to sit down and make a video on what I've learned in the last year and a half working as a security analyst and just pieces of advice I would share with you guys when or if you are starting a career in cybersecurity, especially as an entry-level cybersecurity analyst. But the first piece of advice that I wanted to give you guys is something that my red team mentor actually shared with me when we first started our mentoring sessions. And she was talking specifically about when you're doing a capture the flag or trying to figure out a problem with something that you're trying to hack into or your code. But this could definitely be applied to anything in your early career. And that is to not push yourself to the point where you want to give up and you're sick of this. And when she told me this, it was actually really funny because the first few times I did capture the flags myself without any handholding from another mentor or someone else, I basically was just brute forcing everything and trying to figure things out by Googling and doing random stuff. But at some point, it's just like you're a beginner and you don't even know what to look for or what tools to even use because you don't know that they exist or that you can even do something a certain way. So because of that, ever since I started mentoring under her, she basically has this teaching foundation where she will give me a problem and then I'm gonna try that and I'm gonna like give it my all to actually try my best and try to figure it out. And if I figure it out, then that's great. But if I don't, then I'm also not going to stay up all night trying to figure this out and devoting all of my time and energy to this. So I guess the point is to keep things fun and don't force yourself to try to figure something out if you really have no clue what to do. And that's something that she has really drilled into me because even when I'm trying to figure out something for assignments that she gives me, I don't stress out as much. I actually find it more fun. And honestly, if you're going to be working yourself to the bone trying to find an answer to a solution without reaching out for help after days or weeks of trying to figure out yourself, then you're just going to burn yourself out. And honestly, you're going to quickly lose the passion that you have for what you're doing because you're always going to feel frustrated and angry and upset that you can't do this and think that you actually can't do it after a certain amount of time. So that's why you really want to get the help that you need and don't be afraid to get the help that you need. The second piece of advice, which is to not be afraid to ask someone to shadow them or mentor them. So specifically in my company, there are multiple different pen testing teams and multiple different people on those teams from different backgrounds. So you're bound to be sitting in on a team call where you're hearing someone present about something, about a project or an app that they hacked into recently, and you might be interested in learning more about what they're doing. So a lot of the mentors that I have myself are ones that I reached out to personally, but then there are people that I shadow that is set up by my program, which is why I really recommend reaching out yourself and being proactive and trying to meet people that you actively want to shadow. And this doesn't have to be like a daily, weekly thing. I have people that I shadow every 3 weeks or even monthly if they don't have the bandwidth. And you know, I don't expect everyone to give me their time on a silver platter just because I asked to, you know, shadow them. But I do think that there are people out there that want to shadow and want to share what they're doing, especially if you're in your entry level career and you're just trying to learn as much as possible about different roles and different teams in your company. So never be afraid to ask for shadowing or mentorship, because right now I'm shadowing probably 4 different people. Actually, I'm shadowing about 5 different people right now. Of course, get your manager's approval. Like, you don't want to do anything like behind your manager's back and have any issues with that. Definitely talk to your manager first and say that you want to potentially shadow someone on a different team or just learn more about what someone else is doing. I mean, I don't think that's weird, especially in your early career. And honestly, your manager might be open to it and be like, yeah, I can introduce you to people if you want. Just let me know who and what team and how I can help you. So there's a lot of people out there who are willing to help as long as you ask. And I think that's one of the most important things that I learned in the last year and a half working in a full-time job. And I really think it's also one of the key things that helps me expand my network. Okay, so another thing is specifically in cybersecurity, there's so many people trying to get certifications. And for me, I got my Security Plus certification last November. I can link a video on all the resources that I used to study for it if you guys haven't watched that already in the link below. But one thing that I want to share is even without like the entry level stuff, there are teams in my company that are studying for the Certified Ethical Hacking certification as well. While that isn't something that I'm currently studying for officially because I don't think I have hit all of the requirements for it outside of the exam, I'm still interested in seeing what they're studying and their resources that they're using and the questions that come up in those study sessions that they have on like a weekly or bi-weekly basis. And I really feel like it's never too early to start. I mean, extra studying doesn't hurt you, even if I'm not taking the exam anytime soon. But you should always ask around. If you're trying to study for like the CISSP or the CEH or CompTIA Security Plus, you should ask around your company and your team and see like, hey, are you guys studying for any certifications, or do you know anyone who is, or does the company have any resources or like study groups? And you might also be surprised to find a lot of people who are just studying on their own because they don't think anyone else is studying for it. But what's helped me the most is the fact that I was able to study with a group of people who were in my company that were also studying for their Security Plus and also in like their first year of their career. So it definitely really helped kind of bouncing ideas off each other, bouncing resources, and kind of going over like different flashcards and important topics that one of us might have missed. So I think it's really, really important to kind of gather a little community if you do plan on getting a certification, especially because I feel like cybersecurity is the field with the most certifications, or at least from what I've seen. I don't know any other field in technology that focuses on certifications this much. Okay, so another thing that I've learned is that in cybersecurity, a lot of teams try to keep it as simple as possible. It's kind of like the KISS acronym, but basically there are times when you want to do something a certain way that might be really, really complicated. You have to think of all of the attack surfaces that making it super complicated will bring up. For example, I've heard of people who might want to try to make their own cryptographic hashes or cryptographic algorithms, and that is just never a good thing. Like your company should never be creating their own crypto algorithms. I mean, unless they're like a government agency that is supposed to be making these, or you work in like academia, but for the most part, a standard company, you should just be using the secure hashes and algorithms that are already available to you and for everyone else, rather than trying to create your own specific way of doing things or trying to create your own crypto hashes and things like that. And I also found that a lot of teams that simplify things and simplify processes to the point where they can easily explain it in a meeting or easily talk about it or show it in a diagram, those teams seem to get the most productive work done. I mean, sometimes you can't help but make a process really complicated because there are multiple steps in it, multiple teams and people and roles and applications involved. But for the most part, you want to try to keep things as simple as you can when you can. So yeah, that's definitely something that I have learned, because at the end of the day, that saves time and money. And why come up with your own security framework when there are good ones out there on the World Wide Web that are secure and known to be secure that you should follow, specifically for like different guidelines and security frameworks. Okay, so the rest of these tips are going to be more focused on overall general career advice rather than specifically to cybersecurity. And one of them is to not let people take credit for your work. This is definitely something that I feel like I've learned the last year and a half. Anytime you have a chance to talk about what you're doing and what you're contributing to the team and the project, you should talk about it. Anytime you have a chance to demo something or show a vulnerability that you found or something that you did recently, you should share it with the team and kind of show them what you've been working on. Don't take a backseat in your team and in your career, because at the end of the day, people aren't going to know what you did unless you tell them. And I definitely had a hard time kind of advocating for myself in the beginning of my career, but now I definitely feel like I've grown from that and I'm slowly improving. Definitely not perfect yet, but don't let people take credit for your work. Advocate for yourself, and if you did something really cool, tell people you did something really cool, and they'll probably think it's cool too. I think that's one of the most important things to keep in mind. Okay, so the next thing is communication. Whether it's communicating with stakeholders or your team or someone you're working with, you should always try to do your best to communicate with them as precisely as possible, because especially when you're in a virtual environment, there are a lot of things that can come up where maybe you thought that they were going to do this thing, but then they thought you were going to do this thing, and then at the end of the day, like, no one ends up doing it, which can easily happen, trust me. Like, it's easy to get things to slip through the cracks when you aren't communicating with the other person and telling them exactly who's doing what. And this doesn't just go into the work that you're doing, but also goes into teamwork and reaching out to people when you need help or you have questions about something. Because I remember when I first started, I was really afraid to reach out to people. I just thought they would be too busy or didn't really want to help me, or my question was too simple to ask, or I should just not bring it up. And that's definitely not a good mindset, because if you don't ask questions, then you don't learn. And communicating, asking questions, making sure people are on the same page all goes back to your communication skills. And you're gonna have to be working with so many different people, especially in cybersecurity. Like, I can work with up to like 5 or 6 different teams every week, and that changes every week too. So just being able to learn people's communication skills. For example, some people might be really good at getting back at emails, but then some people might never respond back on ping and they only talk through email. Or some people want to call you right away and they want you to share your screen. So yeah, there's basically just a lot of different types of people out there, and the way that they communicate is all different. So getting used to that can be kind of interesting in the beginning, but I really do think it's an important learning process, which also brings me to my next point about being able to speak up during meetings and making sure that you are heard. So if someone invites you to a meeting, even as an entry-level person, they think that you have something to contribute and get from that meeting. Even if you think it's just a sit-in or everyone else is too senior and you don't want to ask a question and embarrass yourself in front of all of these senior-level people or executive people, I get that feeling all the time. But one tip that I recently heard actually from a TikTok video, I think, which sounds kind of weird that this advice is from TikTok. Basically, it's the fact that people usually remember what happens in the beginning and the end of a meeting. Even if you're super introverted, try to get something in the first part of the meeting, like when things are kicking off, and then try to say something at the end. It could be a comment, it could be reiterating someone's quote, or someone's mention about something, or bringing up a question at the end and kind of tying everything up in the call. And people will remember that a lot more than if you just said something in the middle of a call. So that's a piece of advice if you're an introvert and don't really want to talk during meetings, because I mean, sometimes I feel that way, especially if it's people that I don't really know, and when a lot of people are on the call, I just feel less inclined to speak up. But that's probably when it's the most important to speak up. And something that my first manager actually told me is to make sure you try to get a question in on every single meeting that you sit on, even if it's something pretty small, asking about an acronym, what is XYZ, or how is this relevant to you, blah, blah, blah. And that's a perfectly fine way to frame it, especially if you're just starting out in your career. Like, they kind of expect you to ask questions. So I would take advantage of that. This last piece of advice is to make sure you take care of your mental and physical health. So this could be seen as more of a personal piece of advice, but I really do think that if you don't take care of your body and your mind, then you're not going to do well at work, and you're going to have mental fatigue, you're going to have burnout, and just overall just not a good time, trust me. So you really want to take care of yourself, you want to eat healthy, make sure you get a good amount of sleep. I feel like that's the most important thing, because you don't want to wake up at 7 a.m. to go to work and you fell asleep the night before at 3 a.m. Like, it's just not realistic. And honestly, I did that all throughout college for like the first 2 years, but it really does get to you, especially when you're commuting. It's just a bad time if you're gonna be tired all the time and not taking care of yourself. And of course, mental health is just as important. I started journaling when I started my full-time job 2 or 3 months in, because it really helped with my mental health, and I felt like it was nice just getting to talk to myself about my day. Even if it's not daily journaling, I just write stuff down every week just to see what happened throughout the work week. If something really bothered me, if something really good happened, then I'll just write all of those down. And it's pretty interesting to look back on like my previous journal entries now from a year ago, where I was really stressed out about something and at the end of the day ended up not being a big deal anyway, or ended up going fine. So that's why I feel like journaling is so important. Or even if you're not the journaling type, just writing down a list of bullet points of one good thing and one bad thing that happened throughout the week. And it could be as simple as that. Okay, so that's it for this video. I hope you guys liked it. Let me know in the comments below if there are any pieces of advice that you might have from your early career, or even cybersecurity internships, or any other jobs, classes that you've had. And if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe and turn on post notifications if you want to see more videos from me. And thank you guys so much for 1.6k subscribers on YouTube. I'm so grateful for this little community that we're building up. Yeah, I'm super grateful to have you on this road with me. I will be making more videos. I do have a bunch of different video ideas, so definitely stick around for that and subscribe and turn on post notifications. And yeah, I think that's it. So thank you guys again so much for watching, and hopefully I'll see you guys in my next video. Bye.